ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधिताम् भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथिताम् पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीम् भगवतीम् अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्ब त्वाम् अनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी नमोऽस्तु ते व्यास विशालबुद्धे फुल्लारविन्दायतपत्रनेत्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्न पारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः.
Chant verses 18-23.
यदा विनियतं चित्तं आत्मन्येवावतिष्ठते निःस्पृहः सर्वकामेभ्यः युक्त इत्युच्यते तदा यथा दीपो निवातस्थः नेङ्गते सोपमा स्मृता योगिनो यतचित्तस्य युञ्जतो योगमात्मनः यत्रो परमते चित्तम् निरुद्धं योगसेवया यत्र चैवात्मनात्मानं पश्यन्नात्मनि तुष्यति सुखमात्यन्तिकं यत्तद् बुद्धिग्राह्यमतीन्द्रियं वेत्ति यत्र न चैवायं स्थितश्चलति तत्त्वतः यं लब्ध्वा चापरं लाभं मन्यतेनाधिकं थ यस्मिन् स्थितो न दुःखेन गुरुणापि विचाल्यते तं विद्याद्दुःखसंयोग वियोगं योगसंहितं स निश्चयेन योक्तव्यः योगो निर्विण्ण चेतसा.
ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः. Yoga is, in more precise terms, a form of Viyoga, according to Shri Krishna. Union with the Self or with God is, to be more precise, dissociation from the false. If the false is dropped, then you are there already. You are there with the reality. You are the reality, says Vedanta. Therefore, true yoga is really Viyoga, separation. Separate yourself from the conceptual I. Then the real I is ever there. It shines forth on its own. Conceptually, you form an ego within yourself by clinging to thought. Good thoughts or bad thoughts? All thoughts are a bondage when you cling to them. All thoughts are a prison house. Even good thoughts are like a golden cage. And the pure awareness, which we show in the chart too, as the Om, is untouched by thought. Thoughts are mind and intellect. And then they are further connected to sense perceptions on the plane of the body. They are there, you don't have to literally erase them, avoid them, run away from them, that's not the point. But identification with them has to cease. Identification with thought in the form of "this is me" has to cease, and that cessation of identification takes place in the attention that you pay. Mind pays attention to its own falsehood, and then the whole mind loses that mysterious link called identification. For otherwise you would wonder, who is it who is identifying and who drops the identification? Is it not a thought itself? We say, yes, it is a thought, and let it be a thought. So it is through thought, in thought, that this sense of limitation has come about, and then in an interplay of thoughts themselves, identification dissolves away. Who am I is also a thought to start with, and that thought becomes subtler and subtler. The inquirer is also a thought. The observer is also a thought, agreed, but refine that observer, purify that observer. What do we mean by it? Let the observer, let the witness be freed from all conditionings. Today, when I observe a thought, I say that I am not judging it, but I am judging it. Today, as I observe a feeling in me, I say, this is a good feeling, this is a bad feeling. Who is that who says it's a good feeling, it's a bad feeling? Obviously, to say this is good or bad, you already are conditioned. Just as to say this object is good or that object is bad, you already have a certain taste in you, which is a matter of something you borrowed, you drew in the past. So, today in your meditation, when you say, I am not judging, you have to verify. You have to check again. Really? Really am I not judging? And when you further inquire and get closer and closer to that true witnesshood, we say that the observer, thus purified, dissolves away. There is no observer then. Then there is observing without an observer. Observing is the nature of awareness, whereas the observer, if at all it is a separate entity, is another thought only in mind and intellect. So, to begin with, start with an observer, you have no choice. But as you exercise attention in its purer and purer form, you will see that openness which we have been talking about takes place. You are aware and you are quiet, you are quietude itself. And there is no conflict. Then all that thought built dissolves away. There is only perception. There is no concept at all. You do not conceive the ego. You do not conceive the I am so and so. And if the I am so and so, the very platform is not there, where is the question of other forms of it, such as desirer, such as an entity that is afraid, such as an entity that is jealous? You name it, all the forms of egoism are centered in the first assuming of an individualized status. I am so and so. In a very subtle form, the structure takes place. And then that structure gathers to it more and more descriptions. And then it compares itself with other descriptions, other individualities. And sadness, there is fear and what not. So, Lord Krishna has been saying, withdraw the mind again and again. And we say, within the mind a withdrawal has to take place. Not just withdrawal of the mind from an outer object, but within the mind a withdrawal from a conceptualization. Therefore, we have been explaining that when we are hurt, it does good to ask, who is hurt? I am hurt. Who am I? Instead of leading to further build-up, further associated thoughts, upon asking, who am I, you turn inward. So to ask who is hurt, who is afraid, and then to corner that I am hurt, I am afraid, it is me, as you say, okay, corner that me, drive that me to the wall, choke that me, then you arrive at a state of no me, the M-E, the me. The me goes away, and then you stay as pure awareness. The me is a thought. That is the essence of a lot of things that we have said or we are saying. The me is a thought, and undoing of the me is sadhana. And in the undoing of the me, the true I becomes very evident. And of course, when we say it becomes evident, it doesn't mean it comes before you. It never comes before you. The real I never becomes the object. It cannot be. How can the subject become the object? You are the subject, and all that you can do is to remain as the subject without the confusion of the object to be taken as yourself. Any concept is object. Any concept is known. Any concept of I am such and such is known. And the known cannot be the knower. And the knower can never be the known. Therefore, a great master, perhaps I mentioned his name, Jean Klein, says nicely, you can never know the truth. Can be very disappointing, that line. You can never know the truth. Then he softly adds, you can only be the truth. Thank you. One can be the truth. One can never know the truth. You never have it in hand. I got truth. See here, I got. We are so used to that process. I got it. Look. And so on. No. That's not possible. You can only be the truth. You can never know the truth. And in being the truth, in just being the truth, life takes on a totally different quality. When you remain as truth, then there is spontaneity. Then out of that peace, out of that quiet being, out of that conflict-free core in yourself, the personality of yours, with which earlier you had identified, the personality of yours interacts with other personalities, quote and unquote, other personalities in the most harmonious way, while in reality, in your understanding, there is no otherness at all. when people asked Sri Ramana Maharshi, does one help others upon self-realization? The answer was, upon self-realization there will be no other. Others is again a mental concept. Just as within your body you don't look at your hand or leg as something else. Though if there is an injury to the hand, if there is some pain in the leg, action takes place. Action takes place spontaneously. Even as you are listening to a Vedantic lecture, you know, almost without your knowledge, your hand goes to the back if there is an itching there and scratches, even as, oh, I see, the eye is illusory. So you are hearing. The hand goes to the back and whatever other ways, taking care of the limbs of the body takes place, goes on without a sense of division. In the same way, wonderful interaction, wonderful relating with family members and so on and so forth takes place, no problem, even as conceptually you do not have a separate I, but the intelligence in you does use the word I for transactional purposes. Of course, it's not that you then speak a totally different language, throwing everybody to total confusion. Anybody asks, where are you going? Where am I going? Who am I? If you ask to others, it's going to be a big problem. So you play the game, you say, oh yeah, I'm going to temple, I'm going to school, I'm going to the market. So you use the word I, but even as that usage continues, you are aware that there is no separate I. Lord Krishna says, such a dissolution of the false I, or separation from the false conceptual I, is the true nature of union with truth. It is really not a union with truth. It is being the truth and separation from the false. Tonight we see now the next two verses, where in 24 and 25 Sri Krishna once more calls for this withdrawal, this attentive handling of the mind, this alert management of the mind, which is a very subtle affair indeed. Let's read 24 and 25.
Tyaktva sarvana sheshatah.
Tyaktva sarvana sheshatah.
Manasaivendriya
gramam.
Samantatah
Viniyamya Samantatah
Shanai Shanai Ruparamed
Shanai Shanai Ruparamed
Budhyadhriti Grihitaya
Budhyadhriti Grihitaya
Atma Samstambana Kritva
Atma Samstambana Kritva
Nakinchidapi Chintayet.
As we exercise this great alertness, we find that because of habitual forces, desires do rise in us. Likes and dislikes play their mischievous, almost vicious game upon our mind. We find that kama, personal desire, rises forth, gathers a force, gathers a momentum, and what are we to do? We are not to get panicky. We are not to fight with it as though it is a dirty enemy in us. Lord Krishna says, stand desire. Kama, desire, desire for pleasure, desire for position, desire for praise, desire for some possessions, some wealth, whatever it is, personal desire. Desire in the sense of something that proposes a personal gratification. The little I in me feels better. Now, in this process of the little I feeling better, obviously there is a presumption that if I have this, I am better. Why do you think if I have this, I will be better? Oh, this is so nice. This object is so nice. This position is so nice. I have an imagination and it looks so factual. It looks so objective. My imagination, a happiness that an object can give to me, seems to be based on facts. Lord Krishna says, please check on that. Please verify again. He says here, using a very wonderful Sanskrit word, sankalpa prabhavan kaman. Your kama, your desire, maybe for a position, is based upon sankalpa in the first place. What is sankalpa? Samyaktva kalpana. That is how in Sanskrit it is explained. Kalpana is imagination. And samyaktva, samyak means beautiful, fine, good, and so on. Samyaktva is an imagination about goodness, about sweetness, about beauty, and so on. It is easily seen that an object which looks beautiful to me does not look beautiful to somebody else. A position which means a lot to me does not mean much to somebody else. So obviously the idea of great glory in any object, in any position, is a matter of our conditioning. Our minds are colored. Just because 100 others too have the same coloring of the mind, it does not become a reality. Just because millions believed at one time that the sun went around the earth, to oblige them even for a day, the sun did not go around the earth. The sun remained stationary, and it was the earth, and earth alone which revolved around its own axis and around the sun too, in an orbit taking 365 days. It was the earth alone. Though people imagined, everybody imagined, in the same way, millions and millions may imagine that this I is real. And the gratifications that the little I experiences are also real. However, Vedanta exposes this great, grand lie. The little I itself is a myth, and then all the gratifications, all the what you call rides that the little I takes are another myth, are a dreamy affair. The little I, the ahankara, the ego, is first constructed, and it has its insecurity. It has notions of how it may become secure, and has objects, positions, and particular sense contacts take place. There is the illusion in the little I, in the ego, that because of this object, because of this position, because of this sense contact, I am so fine now. However, Vedanta would say that fineness, that peace, that security is the nature of the self, and all that the pleasure, the sense contact, the position did was to set at rest this false unrest in the ego. So the happiness did not come from outside. there was an agitation, and the outer object, yes, quietened that agitation, and the happiness was from within only. However, if this is not understood, the conclusion that our mind would draw is the object gave. And that conclusion which persists, that conclusion which even gets strengthened as we derive happiness apparently from objects, from somebody's praise and so on, makes us go for it, seek it again and again. So I have this notion that if 10 people gather around me and say, how marvelous you are, that is life. For once or twice it happened to me and I felt so good, and therefore now I seek, where are my 10 people, where are the 10, and so on. Now, is that the way, is that the only way to be at peace? Well, that is the way I know, says my ego. And therefore the ego, the false I, has this imagination. What is happiness? It says, 10 people speaking well of me. That is the answer. That is the concept. That is the belief. And based on such belief, which somehow got linked with a setting, an outer setting, there is desire, there is seeking. If more inquiry is done into the affair, if you check that, is happiness possible only through 10 people praising me, then we find that not really. In deep sleep, without any object, I am extremely peaceful. And on many occasions, maybe seeing a sunrise, or maybe seeing the face of a little child, I may experience great happiness. But I forget those so quickly. And somehow my ignorant and confused mind remembers only some particular pleasure trips or some ego trips, and the situation is so messed up that even if a beautiful child with an innocent face and a charming smile upon his lips is right in front of me, the psychological memory, my seeking that ego trip which gave me peace at one time, prevent how sad from seeing the beauty of the child. I have gone to visit maybe some family, and there is this child, and I do say, oh, what a sweet child, and so on. But I also know, they also know, that this is a lip service. It is only to please the parents, or I am supposed to say such things. What a sweet face, and so on. One feels, you cannot really you cannot deceive anybody. It seems that you have deceived, or you have successfully deceived. But you know that nobody is really deceived. There's a little different vibration about a true compliment and about a false compliment. And they too say, oh yes, yes, this child is so sweet. They also are preoccupied with their own thoughts. And the child also gets the message. The child also gives a smile which is full of understanding. I know you adults very well, that sort of. So how long does this game go on? Really, no, there is a lot of pain. Okay, coming back, we see that through memory of some pleasure, there comes about a narrowing in our mind. That is the whole idea. Sankalpa is a narrowing down. Instead of being available to situations on a moment-to-moment basis, sankalpa is a formation in my mind which narrows me down to say, happiness is only in that. Happiness is only in that. I miss those 10 people. Where are those 10 people who praised me so nicely? I may not verbalize it in such, you know, clear terms. we are all very sophisticated people, you know. I miss those people, you know. It was such a pleasure serving them. That's how you put generally. Oh, I see, you enjoyed, and so on. It was in a subtle way, those 10 people actually brought to you egoistic gratification. Whereas, in the case of someone who penetrates, who cuts through this business of sankalpa, the memory forming this concept within us, and that concept coming in the way of our attuning ourselves to the present situation directly. Here is the child's face, here I am, and the memory of some other pleasure comes in between, and in my heart of hearts I am seeking that pleasure. But for saying sake, I say, what a sweet face, you see, sankalpa. Sankalpa has to be seen. We got to become more aware of these formations within ourselves. So in meditation too, I have been saying, become aware especially of the formation of I thought. I am so and so, I am such and such. There is the I, then the I seeks something, and what Lord Krishna is calling as sankalpa is somewhere these two. There is the aham, I, and then there is the kama, what I desire. Between the aham and between kama, there is the sankalpa. There is the notion of happiness, notion of sweetness, of glory about a certain object. Whereas Vedanta would say, sweetness, beauty, joy, etc. are everywhere. Sweetness is there everywhere. It's available. God has put sweetness everywhere. In a tree, in a plant, in a sunrise, in the chirping of a bird, in a plant, in a breeze, in a rainbow, in a plain sky. Everywhere there is sweetness. If your mind were to become quiet, it were to shed this sankalpa, shed this memory, yet quiet mind experiences beauty in a million places. And that is how an enlightened soul, a saint, is seen to be filling in a joy which is incomprehensible to others. Why are you so happy? What happened? The saint would say, I too don't know. I am so happy today. The saint does not know. It is said that Sri Ramakrishna, as an 11-year-old boy or so, was walking by some paddy fields, and at that time a flight of birds was there in the sky. A number of birds in a group were flying. He saw that and he went to Samadhi. He felt so overwhelmed. He said, oh my, what a creation of God. Of course, he being a champion of Bhakti Marga, the language he employs is always with this word God. In Vedanta, in the Jnana Marga, we don't so much use that word God. It is all the same thing. Really, whether you bring the word God or you do not, the common denominator is the little me is not there. In the appreciation of the beauty, that pattern of several birds going together in the sky, in that appreciation, Ramakrishna totally forgot who he was, what test he had to prepare for in tomorrow's class, school, and how the other boys are bullying him, or how the teacher is partial probably to another student, how some other thing, my mom would criticize me, my father would take me to task, I better do that job he gave me. Otherwise, other day he said, my older brother is smarter than me. I have to prove to him that I am equally good, if not better than the older brother. So, we are all carrying through what I called as memory, carrying I thoughts. I am regarded as worse than, or I am regarded as lesser than my older brother. And this is going to be the challenge of my life. I am going to show to my parents that I am not less than my older brother. Ramakrishna had an older brother, incident, and he could have had, if he had consulted us, we would have given him 100 ways to worry. He would have, Ramakrishna, Gadadhar, you know, you could worry, you could, for example, compare yourself with your, did you notice mom is extra kind to your older brother? Did you notice that? So we can offer free consultancy and mess his life up. But Gadadhar, who later became Sri Ramakrishna, had such a pure mind, puro samskara, past impressions, we must say. He had no patience or no leisure to go into all those. When he saw the birds, he was attuned. He was into the birds. Yeah. And he fell down. He fell down unconscious at the age of 7 or 11 or some age. That is one of the recorded things in his biography. The villagers had to come and see what happened to this boy, and they somehow woke him up and asked him, what happened? Did you not eat a good breakfast? And he says, no, when I saw the birds, I felt warmed and I fell down. Oh. Guru Nanak was measuring some wheat. He had a little job when he was not known. He was measuring, and in Punjabi or Hindi, he was saying, ek, do, with that measuring vessel. And he had to do that job. I guess he was working for a little shop, and that was his job. Somebody wanted 15 sairs, sair being a measure. So there is a sair vessel. 1, 2, 4, 5, thus, 11, 12, and he said, thera. And when he said thera, something happened to him. And the thought came to him, thera. Thera in Hindi means yours. Everything is yours, O Lord. There is nothing. So, more than the word, that feeling overwhelmed him. Oh my. And it is said he fell down unconscious. So if you are a saint, you will fall unconscious 7 times. Unconscious, okay, is an extreme case. The idea is, you go into such a rapture, or, why such a big word too, you go into an inexpressible peace within. You are fulfilled. My job is done. I don't need anything. I don't need anything at all. I am so fulfilled. I am so overwhelmed in this way. And to stay there is Atmanishta. And that doesn't prevent you from doing any work. You fall unconscious. You don't remain unconscious. As you are filled with that peace in the undoing of Sankalpa, as per the present shloka, your skills, professional skills and various general knowledge, what I have called as functional memory, is ever available. If you are a mathematician, you will not forget various equations and other things of mathematics. The psychological memory is undone. The functional memory is fully available. And therefore, you deal situations, or you do whatever is possible in circumstances, and the service that you render has that touch of utter spontaneity. No motive, no plan, personally. For me, for that gratification or that building or that beautification of the little me. If I publish this book, then my image would be a little better. If I get an award, whether it is publication of a book, some enterprise, they may get awards too, but all those are incidental. They are aware, oh yeah, but where are they? They are in themselves. They are staying as the pure awareness. Towards this, Lord says, Sankalpa Prabhavan Kaman Tyaktva. So as the habitual mind thing, you pay attention, and in understanding the falsehood of such a extrovert seeking, the extrovert seeking subsides. That is tyaktva. You don't give up like, it's not like taking a pen out of your pocket and I am giving up. This is much more subtle affair. Obviously, giving up desire is not like throwing away a physical object. Desire, you yourself are desire. And therefore we have been saying it is by exercise of great observation and going to the root of the issue, who am I? Who is desiring? Who is desiring? I. Who am I? So, on one hand, prevent the build-up, and on the other, be more focused on what is happening in the mind. Then that observation of what is happening brings a great change in what is happening. It brings about an inner transformation. Lord says lovingly, shanai shanaihi uparamet. This is not an overnight affair, of course. Suddenly nothing happens. Little by little, shanai shanaihi means slowly and slowly, uparamet, withdraw. For this attention doesn't come by. We are attentive for a while, and then again we are distracted. Habits die hard after all. So, all right, you fell, you slipped 100 times. Okay, 101st time, get up and keep going. Many times the fact that we fell disturbs us so much, we are regretting. I have not been succeeding in my meditation, God, and so on. To cry out like that is to further defeat your alertness. This moment, as soon as you recognize, okay, I failed, don't think about that failure. Act, and again act in the present. Okay, right now, I am not going to fail. I might have failed miserably, you know. So acting in the present. Let me briefly say, we have this word introspection, you see. And in the name of introspection, a lot of people generally do this going back for the last 10 hours. Night, you are about to sleep, I want to introspect. I got up at 4:30 and slept again. 5:30 again I got up, slept again. 6:30 I really got up. I should not do that. Once for all, I should keep the alarm for 6:30. And then, oh yes, I had one bitter interaction at 10:30 with my colleague, who normally irritates me. So, whatever, I don't want to go for more examples. You want to retrace, right? You want to... Now, that is considered one kind of introspection. But I would say, on a higher level, that is a very foolish thing to do. On a higher level, if you know you are not able to do anything, that's something. That's a little, you know, looking back has some meaning. But as you get closer and closer to the present topic, it is introspection is to watch the mind as it is now. There is no point in saying, I was so lazy this morning, or I was so short-tempered this afternoon. Forget morning and forget afternoon. How are you now? How are you now? How is the mind now? And if you are thus exercising attention on the mind as it is now, every moment is now only. Every moment in life is now. It is now, now, and now that makes a life of even 100 years. Somebody lives for 100 years. For all the 100 years, he was in contact, really speaking, with now only. And if you can take care of the now, whole life is taken care of. So, we, in this true meditation, watch the mind as it is at this moment, and in that attunement, in that, let's say, connection we build with the now, really we put an end to psychological time itself. It is because I go down and up 100 times, that apart from the clock time, apart from what we call as the chronological time, That is a vyavaharic convenience, a transactional convenience. That is necessary. Apart from the clock time, I have given a sense of reality to psychological time. I feel the pressure of time, or I feel a certain relaxation. Oh, there is a lot of time, and so on. You know, in situation, don't we find different people experiencing pressure or experiencing relaxation? How does that happen? The clock is the same. You know, though some people keep it 5 minutes ahead and so on, that's another topic. Otherwise, your watch, my watch, his watch, her watch, all are showing the same time. But the inner concern, the inner identifications bring about psychological time. Now in the present context, without going far and wide, if you are following the introspection of type 1, retracing the steps, what you did from morning onwards, then you know God is trying as though to erase the axis of time in your mind, but you want to rebuild again and again. You want to again and again draw the time axis in your mind. You conceptualize. Yeah. So it was 3 o'clock when the colleague came and made that usual face. His face is always so dry, no feelings, just makes a comment. And that was unbearable for me. I was already, and so on. So 3 o'clock comes in your mind, 3:30 comes in your mind, 4 o'clock comes in your mind, and then tomorrow at 3 o'clock I have a meeting with him again in the team. So tomorrow 3 o'clock comes in your mind. So please see that there is clock which maintains time, but we in our mind are rebuilding the axis of time. Even as natural forces erase it, we again rebuild. How sad. Lord Krishna says, Uparamet, withdraw, withdraw. Don't go to 3 o'clock, don't go to 5 o'clock. Be here. How is your mind now? Do you feel a certain laziness? Do you feel that even though you are fresh, you just simply want to lie down? Even though you can take up a piece of work, you want to take up something small, easy? Yeah. Even though you have kept made a promise, you want to do something. Many times in the present, in the now, there is such serious contradiction. I am supposed to call somebody at, let us say, 9 o'clock, and it is 9 o'clock now, and I want to do something else. And I am saying, I am interested in self-development and I am analyzing what happened at 3 o'clock. But dear, now you are supposed to do something. How much are you aware of the present responsibility? Why are you so busy with dissecting how you did not discharge some duty in the afternoon? Why don't you apply yourself to the duty at present? Somehow we don't like. You know, I believe in learning from the past. Are you learning from the past? Are you so attached to the past that you want to remain in the past and mess up the present more and more? You know, as you remember 3 o'clock, and then one more duty you let go, and tomorrow you get a chance to dissect this. Last night 9 o'clock, why did not I call when I had promised? You know, I always do like that. I somehow, you know, and so on. More thing gone. Anyway, I need not elaborate further. This uparamet, in simple terms, which in its details has to be worked out by everybody, but in simple terms, in terms of the basic principles, is uparamet, withdrawal. It's a withdrawal from those structures of the mind where psychological time, psychological space, psychological differences, etc. are all brought into picture. Whereas, when you do withdraw, there is no time, there is no space, you are with the present work. You are into the present, and that becomes an all-time meditation. Buddhya dhriti grihitaya, with an intellect that is very firm on this matter. As there is more clarity, even if you don't want, you will be very firm. Clarity is the backbone of higher spiritual practice. you go higher and higher with greater and greater clarity. And the highest point is taking place, or you're enjoying whatever may be happening, but there is no rising of the conceptual eye at all. Total attunement. You are seeing the flight of birds and there is no thought, I am so blessed, and you know, all others are sleeping, I am fortunate one to see this. By the time they come, they won't get this. And so on, immediately to kind of possess it, to kind of make it mine. This sight is mine, and so on. Then you have spoiled the matter. You have no eye rising. You have no owning up. You have no making it, you know, my property. This pleasure is mine. This possession is mine. This invention is mine. This discovery is mine. I heard that somebody went up on a platform and gave a beautiful discourse on the ways of the ego, and then said, I am the first person to find out all this. You know, I am the first person to discover or outline such intricate ways of the workings of the ego and so on, then it's spoiled. So, you now understand what is meant by being the truth. You own the truth, you have lost the truth. And you disown anything, you disown knowledge, you disown ignorance also. You stay in an openness, then you are the truth. And that is called Atma Samsta. Mind established in the self. Na kinchidapi chintayet. Don't again conceptualize, says Sri Krishna. In practical terms, it all boils down to a great attention to any such thing that might rise. If you are attentive, it subsides. If you are not attentive, you ride on it, you ride with it, then you are lost. So, through very alert attention, you remain in the self. Now, Lord again says, please see 26 and 27. Yato.
Manaschanchalamastiram.
Manaschanchalamastiram.
Tatastato niyam yaitad.
Tatastato niyam yaitad.
Atmanyeva vasham nayet.
Atmanyeva vasham nayet.
Prashanta manasam henam.
Prashanta manasam henam.
Yoginam sukhamuttamam.
Yoginam sukhamuttamam.
Upaiti shantarajasam.
Upaiti shantarajasam.
Brahma bhutamakalmasham.
Brahma bhutamakalmasham.
Yato yato nischarati. Whatever be the cause for your mind to run outward, literally nischarati means running outward, and from a deeper consideration forming a concept, the ego idea, I am so and so idea, the visualization, putting oneself into the pigeonhole, describing oneself. You described yourself, you got attached to it, and then you are very fond of how to further beautify it. That is how the egoistic life goes on. So even as the mind, due to whatever reason, builds up a concept about you and is proceeding to further gratify it, Lord says, withdraw. Take note of it. Hey, again I am becoming prestige conscious, race conscious, body conscious, success conscious, wealth conscious. Again I am describing myself as so and so, and I am pleasure. Or sometimes there is pain, and you are attached to pain. One is attached to pleasure as well as attached to pain. That is the interesting thing. One is building up more and more misery also, for oneself. Why do people watch horror movies? Continue to watch that. They get almost the heart attack. And the friend next to them says, "Oh, it looks like it's hard on you. Shall we go out?" "No, no, let us watch more." Or why do some people, you know, eat those green chilies? Tears are flowing down their cheeks. And somebody says, "You know, do you want to stop?" "No, no, it is so good. Take one more." So it is strange. Our mind is attached to not only pleasure, it's attached to pain too. And the attachment to pleasure and pain on a deeper level is an attachment to how you perceive yourself in the process. Like an artist draws a painting and falls in love with it. A sculptor makes a sculpture and falls in love with that sculpture. If that is broken, his heart is broken. After all, it's a stone. It was a stone. You made the stone to have some form and somebody broke it to pieces. Why are you so broken? "No, please don't touch this sculpture. My heart will be broken now," you say. "Touch me not," and so on. Please see the mental process involved. And I am now saying, leave the sculpture behind, leave the painting behind, leave the green chilies behind, leave the horror movies behind. Something is happening inside you. You conceive yourself in a certain way. Whatever might be the stimulus for it, but you felt good. You felt good thinking of yourself in that way. And you want to see yourself in that way only here onwards. But that is never possible in life. The conceptual I just cannot remain the same. It's bound to change, and when it changes, you feel insecure. When the painting is disturbed or torn, the artist is disturbed because of his identification. In the same way, the conceptual I is bound to change, does change, and you feel miserable. Whereas in Atmanishta, that is abidance by the self, which Lord is proposing, you are aware of the concept, which is playing its role, and it may be having its own beauty about it, but even though you are in it, you are out of it too. For you have seen through its nature. You have seen its nature. If you know that the pleasure you are deriving in fame, for example, is a certain mode of the mind, it's a certain mode of the mind, then that knowledge saves you. Just as if you are aware, as you are in a television show, that this fire, which looks so real, maybe I should say what you call that, that large screen you have some places, IMAX theater, and sometimes probably with a curved screen too. And as there is a flood, or as a plane is moving towards you there, it looks like it is straight on you. But if you have perfect knowledge, as you have, you enjoy it. In the same way, the little I goes through various ups and downs, but deeper is your understanding of the little I being a mere thought, greater is the relief, greater is the fearlessness, greater is the depth of peace. You enjoy. As you enjoy the IMAX movie, you enjoy the fame and the infamy. You may become notorious also, or you may become very famous. You may get great pleasure, or you may get great pain, but you know that behind the senses there is the psychological construction of I. And the seeing through that is what Lord Krishna is asking for. He says, niyamya. So it boils down to, you see, more than the structure itself being managed, the sense of reality is being managed. As a sense of reality is rising up by greater attention, thought processes go on without sense of reality about them. Playing the role goes on without being or without thinking it to be too real. And therefore, as the play goes on, as the role playing goes on, and probably wonderful activity place, nothing is barred, nothing is prevented, there is a different quality. There is an instant relief from everything. Moment to moment, it's as though you are doing things and you are stepping to a new zone. You are stepping into new zones, moment to moment. Whereas, if there is a sense of reality about the ego, there is a continuity. The past casts its shadow upon the present. Lord Krishna is saying, as you see through the ego, as you understand that the I in me, the limited I, is illusory, you experience such prashanti, such peace. Prashanta manasam yenam yoginam sukham uttamam. The uttamam sukham, the best happiness is yours then. For all other happiness comes and goes, but this happiness is the abiding one. And one then is Brahman, Mahabhutam Akalmasham. Again praising such a yogi who has undone the false construction of the ego, Lord says in 28 and 29,
Yunjannevam Sadatmanam,
Yunjannevam Sadatmanam,
Yogi Vigata Kalmashah,
Yogi Vigata Kalmashah,
Sukhena Brahma Samsparsham,
Sukhena Brahma Samsparsham,
Atyantam Sukham Ashnute,
Atyantam Sukham Ashnute,
Sarvabhutastamatmanam,
Sarvabhutastamatmanam,
Sarvabhutani Chatmani,
Sarvabhutani Chatmani,
Ikshate Yoga Yuktatma,
Ikshate Yoga Yuktatma,
Sarvatra Samadarshanah,
Sarvatma Darshanah. Yunjan Evam, meditating in this manner, the yogi, the spiritual seeker, Vigata Kalmashah, becomes freed from all impurities. Kalmasha is dirt. Negativities are dirt. False notions are the dirt in us. Kalmasha is all ego-created false fears. A sense of separation itself is dirt. You are never other than others, so-called others. You are never separate from others. Absolute harmony, absolute oneness, or if you want another terminology, absolute unconditional acceptance of others, so-called others, and absolute unconditional acceptance of yourself make for supreme peace. Then you say, how would progress be there if you accept it? If your son is faring very poorly in school, you say, Sonny, I accept you as you are. He will go further down. He will say, you got to whip him up a little bit. You got to give him a piece of your mind once in a while. You got to tell him, you better do well this time, otherwise you are not going to get the movie this weekend. You are not going to play. So put the conditions. That is how we are all living, because we don't know better. In true acceptance, on one hand there will not be inaction, and on the other there would be a stimulation, there would be an inspiration, there would be a a subtle signal given to the other person. Really speaking, lasting change, lasting improvement in the another person, whether it is a child in this example or anybody else. If you want to change somebody very deeply, it has to be a motiveless relationship only. It has to be unconditional. If a condition arises, isn't it? You know, if you do this, I am going to give you that. If you don't do that, I am not going to do that. If there is an if like that in your relationship, all said and done, it is many notches below the perfect relationship. Unconditionally, if you love your child, that doesn't mean inaction. You know, you express concern, oh, you are not doing well. You express, you attune yourself, you take note of his difficulties or her difficulties, but you are not putting pressure. Of course, this has to be arrived at by a great cleansing within yourself overnight. Okay, Swami, words, I am not going to put any pressure, you know. That will be tamas, that will be insensitivity. I am not saying, you know, wash your hands off and then he goes down the drain and you also go down the drain. And there will be, after some time, you will be hunting for me. Where is that Swamiji who gave this advice, you know? After that advice, our family got so messed up here. So we are going back to the old techniques of reward and punishment. You do this, you get $5. And you don't do this, no meal tomorrow. And so on. That reward and punishment was giving some results. So you will hunt for me then. No, then, you know, it is not a matter of overnight deciding and then not doing anything. No. The real process takes place within yourself. As you see for yourself what this reward and punishment is doing to the child, you will let go of the reward and punishment philosophy. The reward and punishment philosophy gets achieved by perpetuating fear, by perpetuating the desire to impress, by perpetuating the desire to prove yourself. Constantly you then are habituated to, I should prove myself. And it's such a burden. Then spontaneous activity becomes very hard. In fact, to have your, in this example, to have your child study better, live better, work better, and whatever, do anything better, spontaneously, it is a prerequisite that you live out of love itself. You love to rise, you love to go for a walk, you love to work, you love to, everything suppose is done by you out of love and not out of a fear, then it's easy to see. There is such a stamp of naturalness about that. Otherwise, I better do this, then my boss will be pleased. So to please the boss, to please somebody, to prove, to impress upon, and you do that, isn't it experienced by us, that unnaturalness? It's a very, you know, hodgepodge, lot of patching up, lot of, it is something but you put another label. There is always two layers. Then life has lost its freshness. In Atmanishta, as Lord says, Vigata Kalmashaha, all those pretentiousness goes away. You are yourself, it's not inaction, it is spontaneous action. But that spontaneous action, naturally, is not one more pretense. You know, I am going to be very spontaneous now. By deciding to be spontaneous, nothing is going to happen. The way to be spontaneous, if you want a way, is to see for yourself the ugliness of pretending. I pretend and there is an ugliness about it. And there is a discomfort also. There is a discomfort about putting up an image always, putting up a facade. So I hate to pretend. I hate to tell a lie. I hate to deceive others and deceive myself. How do you come to hate? If you have seen the ugliness. If you don't see the ugliness, you are very apparently comfortable. You say, karna padta hai. You have to do like that, that is life, like that. And others I know, others also say. And this kritrimata, the artificialities of life go on, and there is such a discomfort, inner pain in us. Vigata kalmashah, I would say, is where such dirt of mere dealing with images, projecting, protecting and pursuing images comes to an end, purified, and he gains Brahma samsparsha. When you are totally yourself and rising or coming forth from the natural peace, actions are taking place, you are in Brahman. You are in Brahman, Brahman nature. Lord says, then not only you have abandoned your images, not only you are yourself, you see others also as themselves. You see, when you stop pretending, you have the moral courage, whatever big words you want to use them there. You have all the strength to say to another, please don't pretend. Please do not do something just to, just to please or just to put up a show. And the other person also gets the message then. A boss, let us say, who himself is very honest, says one word to an employee, it has weight. But if the boss himself is pretending, and he may give volumes of sermon, he may bring 5 books, the evil of pretending, and present it to you on your anniversary or something, that is another pretending care. Okay, it is said, sarva bhuteshu chatmanam, sarva bhutani chatmani. Literally, when you translate this, the yogi sees himself in all and he sees all in himself. So what is the idea? As long as I am attached to an identity, a described I am different from you. You are different from me. But in the letting go of my identity, the identity is brought forth, is recalled for vyavahara, for transactions. And that is not, every time you don't have to say, I am so and so. Every time you don't have to describe your race, your height, your gender or what you call sex, and your qualifications. No. Only sometimes. And that time you say, and it's purely for vyavahara. Otherwise, the mind of such a purified soul is so quiet. It is in such an... And then what happens is, you are free from the burden of any identification, and you see others also as that awareness alone. Because their being so and so doesn't mean anything to you. Somebody is, let us say, a Nobel laureate. Oh yeah, you understand what it is. But it has no bearing on probably, playing a game of chess with him, or playing golf with him. He may be. Whereas generally, please see this, we get so conscious. Yesterday I played golf. You know who it was? That was a Nobel laureate. What has Nobel Prize got to do with playing golf? But we bring the descriptions of everybody into all irrelevant areas. And you stop totally bringing the irrelevant descriptions to different areas, then what is called in modern language as an image-free relationship takes place. You are not clinging to your image. You are forgetting, maybe you are a wrestler. You got a prize last week for in wrestling. You forget you are being wrestler and you forget his being a Nobel laureate. because in playing golf these are not relevant, and you are into the game of golf, and apply that to any other situation. So the doing away with the I am so and so leads to a very wonderful way of relationship with everybody, and that is, if you think about it, that is exactly this thing. You see yourself in all and all in yourself. Traditionally for this shloka some Vedantic examples are given. It is said that water is in all the waves and all the waves are in water. So in the same way, a person who has realized Brahman is like water, and he is in everybody, everybody is like wave, and everybody is in him. Waves are in water and water is in waves. Therefore the yogi is in all and all are in himself. Very good, the example. So simple it is. Let us go to next shloka. We say, that doesn't hold water. It doesn't take you far. So you got to go deeper and say, what is this? What does it mean to be just pure awareness, which the Om is? The Om is pure awareness. There is no I am so and so in it. Pure awareness. I would say, dismiss all descriptions the moment you see it as irrelevant. And a lot of descriptions are simply irrelevant in very many situations. Though here and there, my race becomes relevant at some place. My sex, male or female, becomes relevant. My nationality is relevant at some place. Do bring it out when it's relevant. But don't you bring that when it's not relevant, then there is a tremendous change. You have to first become aware of how you are constantly carrying it, constantly bringing it, others also bring it. And if you say, you know, I have to bring it because others are bringing it, that doesn't go too far. You make a beginning and you discard it. So you discard this obsession with your particular description, and then you stay as the awareness. And as awareness, it is true that all are in you and you are in all, because there is only oneness. There is only oneness. In the identification, which is through thought, as I have explained, the oneness is gone. Strongly feeling now that, you know, I am a sannyasi and these are all householders, you know, and I don't know how far they understand Vedanta or whatever. If I think I am a sannyasi, I am a monk, whatever, in some way I describe myself and cling to it with certain force, then there is duality straight away. There is no duality but for clinging to a description of oneself, that too in an irrelevant context. So, sarva bhutastam atmanam, sarva bhutani chatmani, ikshate, one sees, sarvatra samadarshanaha. Then no status of anybody puts a weight upon you, as I illustrated. Someone being a noble laureate, very fine, all respect, but it doesn't put a weight upon you in all other contexts, and that is samadarshanaha. Now we see two more. Yo maam pashyati.
Yo
maam pashyati sarvatra.
Sarvam cha mai pashyati.
Sarvam cha mai pashyati.
Tasyaham na pranashyami.
Tasyaham na pranashyami.
Sachame na pranashyati.
Sachame na pranashyati.
Sarva bhutasthitam yomam.
Sarva bhutasthitam yomam.
Bhajati katva mastitah.
Bhajati katva mastitah.
Sarvatha vartamanopi.
Sarvatha vartamanopi.
Sayogi mai vartate.
Yogi Mai Vartate.
In the 29th, which we saw before, the Lord said, the Supreme Yogi sees himself in all and all in himself. Whereas in the 30th verse, he says, the Yogi sees me in all and me. Me means the Lord, God Himself. Lord Shri Krishna, God, is talking. So, all in the yogi, and yogi is in all, and all are in God, and God is in all. This is like saying first A equals B, and then saying C equals B. Mathematics would have it, A equals B. If all are in the yogi, and yogi is in all, and all are in God, and God is in all, then the yogi is one with God. And what is more, A equals B equals C. All the yogi and God are all one. God too is that awareness principle. Everybody really is awareness principle. Due to ignorance, they may be clinging to their images. That is their problem. And hopefully that problem will end. Every one of us, what a wonderful thing here, it is said here. Every one of us is that one awareness only. Oneness only. It's not that there is one awareness here, and another awareness there, and third awareness there. No. There is only one awareness. But through thought, there are many egos. Just as a traditional Vedantic example goes, you see, one sun up in the sky, and in many, many buckets filled with water, there are many images. If your attention is on the images, there are many suns, reflected suns. And how could those images come about? In water. Thoughts are like water. In the medium of thoughts, the image formation takes place. I am so and so, idea takes place, and you are carried away by that I am so and so idea, you become a separate entity. He becomes another entity, she becomes another entity, and there is plurality. Now, there is the water, there is the image, lift your head up and see the sun, there is only one sun. In the same way, if you can, in a figurative language, step out of thought. Step out of thought. Go away from water and look up. There's only one sun, there's only one awareness. And God, Lord Krishna, is ever free of any image. People looked at him as son of Vasudeva. People looked at him as husband of Rukmini and whatever, in various ways. But he never looks at himself in that way. And therefore he says, Arjuna, I know I am awareness, and in this awareness, living beings, names and forms, individualities appear and disappear. All are in me, I am in them. And a yogi too, through that insight of his being the awareness, knows that he is in all him. And therefore, these two shlokas together make for what we traditionally call as Mahavakya. Mahavakya, great statement, such as Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi, and so on, by definition is a statement which shows oneness of individual and God. Jiva Brahma Aikyam Pradarshyati Yat Tad Mahavakyam. That's the definition. And these two shlokas together do that job. And Lord, in a very sweet language, says, as someone among us, anywhere, as someone thus sees me everywhere, in everybody, and sees everybody in me, that means, as someone gets established in this oneness in this universe, because as awareness there is oneness, I never leave him, and he never leaves me. The second line of 30th verse. reach me. Yogi and God, they have a wonderful all-time romance, the devotee and Ishwara, or put it as a relation between a mother and child. The mother never would deny care, would deny help, would deny love to the child. The mother's hand is ever stretched out for the child, and the loving child too ever holds on to the mother's hand, and they are walking together. So the mother says, I never leave my child, and the child never leaves me. Or for that matter, in any wonderful rapport, it is like that. Tasyaham na pranashyami sachamena pranashyati. This is a beautiful line from the spiritual point of view, which is not different from what we have said about a wonderful rapport between any two people. What is meant is, the yogi never leaves God. What does it mean? The yogi never slips from that understanding that he is that awareness which God too is. And God never leaves the yogi. It has this implication that God, you know, from a point of view of path of knowledge, he is that cosmic intelligence. He is the total intelligence. He is something that pervades through the whole world. God is related to the whole world. I and you, from ordinary considerations, are related to a little world of our own. God is connected with the whole world. So totality and individuality are God and man. Now, God doesn't leave man means the supreme intelligence in this world always functions through this man. This man then becomes the vehicle, this then becomes the conduit for the supreme intelligence to function. And that is how we see the saints, great sages, etc., are able to touch the lives of large numbers of people. Whatever they say, whatever they do, or whatever they don't do, they sit quiet and people are influenced because God functions through them. So they are attached to God and God is attached to them, and such is the condition that just comes about in self-knowledge. Finally, we read the 32nd verse, Atma Upamyena.
Atmaupamyena sarvatra,
Atmaupamyena sarvatra,
samam pasyati yorjuna,
samam pasyati yorjuna,
sukham vayadi va dukham,
sukham vayadi va dukham,
sa yogi paramo matah,
sa yogi paramo.
In 31, which I did not comment upon, the Lord says, as one comes to see me as present in all living beings, there is the expression, sarvatha vartamanaha pi. Vartamanaha means being. Being in sarvatha in all possible ways, meaning whatever be his station, his status. For example, whether he is a householder or a monk, a woman or a man, to whatever race he might belong, to whatever professional denomination he might belong, just doesn't matter, city or village, healthy or sick, famous or unknown. Sarvatha vartamanaha means no matter how society looks at him, if a man or woman, that is implied, if a man has this knowledge, he is in God. Samai vartate. And of all yogis who are attempting, see, your word yogi at places stands for the realized soul, at other places stands for a seeker on the path. If you take the second meaning, among all seekers who have reached different levels of clarity about this self-knowledge, that man indeed is the supreme yogi, yogi paramo mataha, who is looking at everybody as himself. Atma upamyena. Upama means a comparison. And atma upamya. Upama becomes upamya. So he looks at everybody as comparable with himself. And as Lord Krishna himself makes it clearer, sukham va dukham, whether it is pleasure or pain, in happy circumstances as well as in unhappy circumstances, the perfect yogi looks at others as himself, meaning he has perfect understanding. In other words, he becomes insensitive. Vedanta is just the opposite. Vedanta or true spirituality, rather than making anybody indifferent to the sorrows of the world, these ignorant folks are suffering, it's all self-created, you know, and so on. It appears that Vedanta would make one indifferent, because for him the world is an illusion. If you make a hasty reading of Vedanta, it would appear that as you become more and more spiritual, you distance yourself away from the world. Look at, stand at a good distance and look at them. I too was like that, now I have changed. You sort of move away. You don't have any concern. No. Lord says, the contrary is the truth. You become so aware. You not only see the superficialities, you see people on a deeper level. You see people as yourself. In fact, your foolish days help you now to understand much better. To say that I too was like that would not make you insensitive. Rather, you know how you moved from your foolishness to wisdom, and therefore you would feel concerned. And such a concern, such a sensitivity, heightened sensitivity, is the hallmark of the perfect yoga. Sorry, I took a little extra time. Are there a couple of questions? Maybe we can, oh, it's a weekend after all, we can take a few more minutes and have, as we have been having, a little bit of question and answer and a little bit of meditation, I guess. Are there some questions? Yes. Oh, the being done in Chinmaya Mission, San Jose. Right at downtown, we have this facility on Park Avenue. And there are classes for adults by me. I offer some 10 lectures through the week. 8 of them in center itself, one at Los Altos, and one in Hindi at Fremont Temple too. So Vedanta classes on Gita, Upanishad, Ramayana, etc. are held by me. And then we have classes during weekend for children called Bal Vihar, from the age 5 till they are 17 years old. So 5 to 17 we have classes for different age groups for children, where spiritual matters, cultural matters are taught. And we hold camps, we hold day camps, day camp, you know, just for a day. Like next month on December 14, we have a 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. camp on a Saturday. December 14 is on Manusmriti, which is a traditional, an old Dharma Shastra text. And so various programs, celebration of festivals, and even some social work. Every quarter our volunteers go to a homeless center and do this feeding of the homeless. Did I miss out something? So basically it's like a school. It's the education is our main work. School education for adults, education for children, teenagers. and so on. And we have our newsletter. We have many publications. We run our own bookshop there. We have audio cassettes, video cassettes, lectures by Swami Chinmayananji on books, on tapes, and so on, in various languages. And then additionally, the facility on Park Avenue also provides venue for dance, music, etc., which is not directly our work, but we provide. The dance teachers, music teachers of the area come and teach there. That also is encouraged by us. We have a Chinmaya homepage, www.chinmaya.org. If you say chinmaya.org organization, you get a lot of, that's the best thing. You are all, so many things are given there about us. I am personally on email too. You could send questions to me. Chidananda@chinmaya.org. That is personal email. Just for a couple of minutes, let us observe our own mind, our own ego, and attempt a naturalness in ourselves. Let's attempt being ourselves rather than getting caught in any concept, any image. With all alertness, just see the concept formation, become aware of any regret, become aware of the chatter of our mind. In any form, and as you become aware of thought, you feel like pursuing a thought, defending, justifying, attaching a value to it, and whatever. So you do something with the thought. I request you, do not judge the thought, do not build further. Instead, stay in the observation. Especially take note of thoughts related to the I. For example, thoughts flowing, I should have done this, I should not have done that. I will say this, I will do that tomorrow. In 100 ways revolving around an I, actions, words, thoughts are planned. Become aware of that movement of the I. In fact, you may repeat the word I softly in your mind. I, to help this focusing attention on the nature of I. When I am trying to understand myself with all earnestness, this earnestness to understand myself is the basis of true meditation. Who am I? I want to understand. I am not interested in becoming something, projecting myself in some way. I want to know myself. I want to understand myself. With this approach, again take a look at the present notion you have of I.
Hari Om.